Well, hello and welcome to Stand in the Gap. I'm Sam Rohr, and I'm joined again today by Pastor Isaac Crockett. And on this program, we focus on transcending cultural issues which seem to have no solution in this COVID-19 era. Governments of the world have marched nearly lockstep, have they not, in response to this end times type plague. And through remarkably common policies, governments have departed from historic health-related protocols, destroying entire economies and transferring trillions of dollars of wealth. They've locked down billions of the world's population, greased the path for famines, greater government surveillance, and all with no real hope for the future. Into these strange times that will be with us for years, God has been absent from government policies and government discussions. Seeking God's face for how to deal with such challenges has been discounted as unnecessary and a waste of time. This is sadly predictable as the world and our nation here in America places experts above God and man's wisdom above God's wisdom and human thought above the Word of God. Now we face an unfolding time of increasing rebellion and lawlessness. Governments impose restrictions that limit freedom and impose measures of bondage. In the streets of America, demonstrations have become the norm, with an attitude of lawlessness and superiority being evidenced toward others. This requires, of course, more and more government, with greater and greater turmoil as the result. Citizens around the world are despairing and calling out for help, grasping for hope. Yet without God, government is incapable of offering hope outside more government. Yet for those who want and truly want a solution, God has already established the plan for order and blessing in our nation or for any nation. And that plan hinges on the understanding of authority. And that's going to be the focus for this program and our next. Our theme is this: understanding biblical authority, God's antidote for rebellion. So in this program, Isaac and I and special guest Pastor Paul Blair, who leads Liberty Pastors and who is the senior pastor of Fairview Baptist Church in Edmond, Oklahoma, will be our guest on this critically vital topic. On part one of this emphasis, we're going to discuss authority. In today's program, we're going to look at authority, God's design for order and purpose in society, and then we're going to look at God's design for the citizen, the individual, and the family. Next week in part two, we'll conclude with authority, God's design for the civil ruler, the bearer of the sword, and God's design for the church and the pastor. All this and more on Stand in the Gap. And with that, let me welcome right now to our program a good friend, Paul Blair. Paul, thank you for being with us today.
Sam, it is my pleasure. It's good to be with you and Isaac this morning, and thank you for having me on.
It's a pleasure to have you on, Paul. And we have a great topic to discuss, because it's not only a point that's very little discussed, it brings solutions to a need. I'm going to read, if you don't mind, Paul, I'm going to read from the book of Isaiah, just a couple of verses. Isaiah chapter 1, verses 2 through 7, because I think it lays out God's analysis for even our culture, but it was Israel. He said this: "Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, but they've rebelled against me. The ox knows his owner, the ass his master's crib, but Israel, my people, doth not know. My people doth not consider." Then he says, "Ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They've provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger, and they're gone away backward." And then it says this, he says, "Why should you be stricken any more? Will ye revolt just more and more?" He said, "The whole head's sick, the whole heart is faint." He said, "From the sole of your foot, even of the head, there's no soundness, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They've not been closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment." And then this, he said, "Your country is desolate. Your cities are burned with fire. Your land Strangers devour it with your presence. It's desolate, overthrown by strangers. Paul, just briefly, lay out here for us, if you could, why is God's order for authority the answer to rebellion, disorder, and confusion?
Well, Sam, as you were reading that, I couldn't help but smile. You know, God sits here and reminds them of blessings when you do things His way, because He's wiser than we are, and curses when we don't do things God's way. And He makes a statement that even an ox knows better, and even a donkey knows better. The reality is that every issue that we've dealt with or we're dealing with today, God has dealt with in Scripture. You know, Solomon said that there is nothing new under the sun. And of course, with man's wicked heart, God has always, you know, beginning at Babel, when Nimrod sought to concentrate power and establish that first global tyranny, you know, God always understood you had to separate power in with man's sinful heart. And every issue that we deal with today, God has dealt with, and He's assigned to one of four realms of government. And we typically think of government, we immediately default and think of the United States Capitol building or something like that. No, that's not biblical understanding of government. It begins with self-government, then reaches out to family government, then reaches out to church government, and then finally is the era or area of civil government, each with defined, limited responsibilities. And when we put the problems in the proper category, it always works out well. And we ultimately glorify God and we receive the benefits of it.
Paul, fantastic setup. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back and we're going to follow the order, and that's our purpose here. God's order is the antidote to rebellion and disorder. We're going to talk about that next. We'll be right back.
Truth, flexible or permanent? The Bible, ancient history or powerfully relevant? Culture, a reflection of enlightenment or warning signs? The pastor, commentator, or frontline combatant? Every day, American Pastors Network speaks to these questions where and when they matter. With hundreds of affiliate radio stations nationwide, a website and mobile app screening today's headlines through the twin lenses of the Bible and the Constitution, educating, informing, equipping. This is the American Pastors Network. The time is now to stand in the gap for truth.
Welcome back to the program. Sam and I are talking with our guest, Pastor Paul Blair from Oklahoma, and we're talking about authority, we're talking about government, and Paul, you just explained that there's four different governments, and you said it starts with individual and family. Well, let's look at individual, or you called it self-government. One of the first passages I memorized as a child was Psalm 100. Psalm 100, the third verse of that says that, "Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are His people, and the sheep of His pasture." So we know that God created us. He created Adam and Eve as individuals. So what is that responsibility that we have to God, our Creator? We are His people. We are His sheep. He's our shepherd. What responsibilities as individuals do we have to God?
Well, specifically, you know, the Scripture says, in fact, the Apostle Paul says that we are to glorify God in our body and in our spirit, which belongs to Him. So we're responsible for our own physical bodies. We are responsible for the decisions that we make and ultimately the consequences, for those decisions that we make. You know, as we see what's going on right now, some of the discussion of reparations and things that are coming up for sins from generations hundreds of years ago. Well, the Scripture says that the soul that sinneth, it shall die. So with self-government, it covers such things as our decisions to trust Christ or not. Whether we bend our knee to Jesus and are born again or not is our responsibility. It's not mom's, dad's, not anybody else's. It's my personal responsibility. So that would fall under the area of self-government. Feeding myself is my responsibility. You know, Paul, in talking about some lazy peoples that just refused to go to work there in Thessalonica, he said, hey, let them go hungry. Hunger's a great motivation. If they're just lazy and refuse to eat, then don't feed them. That will motivate them to get back to work. So feeding, taking care of ourselves, providing for ourselves is a part of self-government. And then as we discuss healthcare and things, your body is your most precious personal property. And understand that with responsibility over something also comes control. So for example, Isaac, if I had assumed responsibility for paying your medical bills, then all of a sudden you're gonna have to call me before you go outside. You call me and say, hey, Brother Paul, I wanna go snow skiing. I'm gonna say, no, Isaac, I don't think you can go snow skiing because I'm paying for your medical bills. So with responsibility comes control. But just very simply, those are some of the examples. It all begins, that first concentric circle, self-government begins with us. Personal decisions pertaining to feeding ourselves, working, glorifying God in all that we do, taking care of our own bodies and the like.
Paul, excellent. And I'm going to follow up with you and say our founders understood that. The Declaration of Independence said Our God Creator gave us individual inalienable rights, life, liberty. That's exactly what you're talking about, perfectly stated. But God laid out some of these basic duties to all of mankind at creation, but they didn't do it, and they went their own way. Ultimately, God then delivered, through Moses, the 10 moral commandments of God. Our founders identified that and said, for self-government, people have to limit their actions according to the 10 commandments of God. That's our history in this country. Tie in the Ten Commandments and why God gave that and why they are for providing order in society. Again, part of God's order, why that works and why it's so important.
Well, I'm glad to do that, Sam. First of all, understand that, you know, for the first 400 years, Israel operated much like we were designed to operate. They were a constitutional republic. The law was the Constitution of Israel. And when Moses went up and down Mount Sinai, bringing back God's instructions, the first thing that he came back with was the Ten Commandments. That was the basics of self-government. You know, our obligation to God and our obligation to each other. We get those things right, and then we've got a good foundation and a good start with the rest of it. But, you know, with the, love the Lord, honoring the Lord, worshiping the Lord, then, you know, we've got the establishment of the home, and then we've got don't steal, don't covet, don't cheat, don't everything else that goes along with that. So foundational, it begins with self-government. It worked out from that. The next came with the statutes, which pertained to civil government. Then the judgments came with Israel's temple worship and the things along those natures. But in order to have limited civil government, in order to not need a policeman on every corner to make us do right, then we have to be governed somehow. So we are governed internally. As Christians, we are indwelt by the Holy Spirit, and as a country that was established on a biblical worldview based on the Ten Commandments, then we are taught right from wrong from the very get-go. You know, our founding fathers all said, you know, Benjamin Franklin said that as man becomes more corrupt, he needs more and greater masters. John Adams said, our Constitution is made only for a moral, a Christian, and religious people. It's wholly inadequate for the government of any other. So it's that same idea. As Representative Winthrop of Massachusetts made, I think 1852, he made the statement in Congress that man must be governed somehow, either by the Bible or by the bayonet. So we either have lots of policemen, lots of laws, lots of walls, lots of fences, making sure that man toes the line because we have no ability to govern ourselves, or if we want freedom, we have to have that inherent self-government, of course, ultimately being controlled by the Holy Spirit. And when no one is watching us, we know that God is watching, and we choose to do right. So that's why self-government, the Ten Commandments, so fundamental, so important to enjoying the free constitutional republic that we have enjoyed for the last 240 years here in the United States of America.
So, Paul, we had God's order. Our founders understood it, adopted it. That's where we are right now. It comes back to basics, ladies and gentlemen, very basics. But, Paul, let's go ahead, because after God laid down the basic self-government authority structure, he very then quickly, Adam and Eve, established the family, and he gave mom and dad duties and responsibilities. What are the duties? What are the responsibilities of mom and dad within the family unit? We say often the building block of society. Why is that order? What are the duties? What are the responsibilities that, when done properly, bring order to a otherwise disorderly culture?
Well, the scriptures tell us that we are to raise our children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So we are to teach our children to glorify God, not just by lectures, but also by example as we train them up in the way that they should go. And, you know, God's design is so efficient. You know, think about it. You've got a mom and dad that God blesses with individual children, and then that family unit, that mom and dad oversees their care, their provision, their training, their discipline, and everything. And of course, they were taught they were told by God to teach them about God and teach them about their history, who they were to God, who God was to them. What a perfect, efficient design. One nation or one generation teaching the next. Now you have what we have today, and you have the central government tasked with training all the children in all of America. And of course, the foundational education that we had, parents were supposed to train their children to love God, to fear God, to trust God. Whenever the government gets in charge, we've taken God out of the equation, government replaces God in the equation, and then the government schools teach all the children of the land to fear the government, to love the government, and to trust the government. Well, that's not what the biblical mandate was for us. And that's one of the reasons why every totalitarian society, that monarch seeks to gain control of educating the children, because they believe that within 10 years, they can literally control the whole country if they grab that next generation of child. And God told us to do it His way. When we do it His way, it always works well. When we don't do it His way, it always works in disaster.
Paul, with just in a few moments, can you explain to us, kind of boil it down to, what are some of the essential things that we need to do in our families to do it His way? What's essential for doing it God's way to have that family authority work the way God ordained it to?
Well, very simple. First thing, Dad, love Mom as Christ loved the church and gave Himself for it. Second, Mom, submit yourself to Dad's godly authority within the home. Raise your children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Parents, teach your children how to budget. Teach your children how to work and pay their bills. And then God's design is for the parents to take care of providing for their children as they're growing up. And then, marvelously, in the parents' old age, it's supposed to be the children honoring their father and mother and taking care of their parents in their older senior years. Nowhere in the Bible is it the civil government's responsibility to oversee the education of children or to oversee the welfare of an aging society.
Well, when you explain it like that, it makes a lot of sense, and you can see how that could very drastically change our society in a positive way if it was taken that way. Sam, I want to ask you, because you've been in office you've spent a long time in political office, you've been involved in church leadership, and then of course father, husband in your home, so you've kind of gone through these different jurisdictions. Could you maybe give us some of the importance of even as Paul was just talking about, that God gives separate distinctive responsibility to the different governments, to individual, family, civil, and church?
Isaac, absolutely. And I think that's probably one of the most profound applications of understanding of authority. And ladies and gentlemen, if you're watching, you heard what Paul Blair just shared. It's very simple. When you think individual, mom and dad, children, building block of society, families operating together forms community, and then when you extend beyond that and they adopt a common view of God, we would say a biblical worldview in our nation, a Judeo-Christian worldview, then in fact you can have what we've had, freedom, prosperity, and blessing in this nation. The distinctions, though, are very critical as we build it out in this program and the next. When the individual attempts to do what the mom and dad are supposed to do, if the child tells mom and dad, I am an individual, but I'm going to tell you what to do, you've got rebellion, you've got trouble. If mom and dad try to tell those in civil government, this is what the policies ought to be, and without consideration for the purposes of government, which we'll talk about, then they're out of step. If civil government, as Paul made very clear, steps in to the family and tells you as mom and dad, this is what you must teach your children. This is how you must teach your children. And this is where you must teach your children. They've overstepped God's order. At that point, you have a disruption of God's order. It brings disorder. And Isaac, it's that simple. God has his own distinctive areas. And when we follow it, as Paul made very clear, God blesses. And when we think we have a better way, we always end up in trouble like we are in this country today.
Sam and Paul, what you all are saying, it's simple, but it's extremely important, and it needs to be done right. We're going to take a brief time out. When we come back, we're going to look at how we can very simply apply these truths to our lives.
Stand in the Gap is produced and recorded in the studios of WBPH Philadelphia, positively different television.
As we wrap up today's program, our guest is Pastor Paul Blair, founder of Liberty Pastors. They work in close association with the American Pastors Association, Pastors Network. Paul is a pastor of a church in Oklahoma. And Paul, it's been great to have you on the program today. We're talking about authority, and we're doing that because as you and I and others have talked about it, we're saying this is one of the greatest needs in America. But it goes to the heart of a solution to the problems that we're seeing of rebellion in our streets. So let's go back, because under the concept of authority, there's God and then there's authority underneath of it. Authority embodies the concept of accountability. Anybody's been in the military, they understand that. But build out briefly the authority structure, again, that we've talked about, God's authority structure, and how the accountability should work. Individual, God, family, God, and the others. Put that together as a concept here as we close the program.
Well, just very simply, and if people, the basics of a biblical worldview, by the way, that's what America was established on. That was our foundation. When it says in the Declaration of Independence, the laws of nature and nature's God, that was stating that we are building our society. In fact, we are justifying our separation from Great Britain on natural law, on the Bible. We have this right. The purpose of government is to defend the unalienable rights that God has given to mankind. God is brilliant. His ways are far above ours. His thoughts are far above ours. And God has already answered the questions before we've even asked them. So at creation, Garden of Eden, at Mount Sinai, and then on unfolding, God has assigned to every issue that we face in human civilization and has given that area of responsibility to one of four realms, either the self-individual, self-government, or the family government, or church government. And then finally, the very smallest area and supposed to be the least invasive was the area of civil government. Each have defined areas of responsibility, easy to see in Scripture when you're looking for them. But Karl Marx, back in 1848, had an atheistic idea of wanting to do away with God. And in order to accomplish his goals, he wanted to destroy morality. He wanted to destroy the family unit. He wanted to destroy the church. And then when you look at those four realms, if you do away with those, all that's left is the mighty, powerful state to take care of every issue. Where are we today? Well, now we're in a position, it doesn't matter what it is. Doesn't matter whether it's a racial issue or whether it's a pandemic, whatever. We are always looking to the almighty civil government to solve every problem.
And Paul, I'm going to have to step in right now because we're out of time. Ladies and gentlemen, as we wrap up this program, the concept is God established it all. Whether you're an individual, you're going to be accountable to God. Mom and dad, you're accountable to God. Civil government ruler, you're accountable to God. Pastor in church, we're accountable to God. You get that? You get the understanding of authority. We thank you for watching us today. This is part one. We will come back in next week's program. We'll talk about civil government that carries the sword. We'll talk about the church, and we'll wrap all of this together again. God's concept of authority, biblical worldview, the antidote to rebellion and disorder in our society.